Sometimes in class, I'll ask my students to tell me something that has a quantity larger than a googol. Grains of sand on Earth is a popular first response, and I say no, googol's much bigger. Stars in the universe, molecules in the ocean, number of words spoken by humans ever. Nope, a googol is still much bigger. Finally, someone says, number of atoms in the universe. And it always seems to be said with a confident tone because clearly that is reaching an uncountable and incomprehensible number. So should be more than a googol. What do you think? Are there more than a googol atoms in the observable universe? And how do these other quantities compare to a googol? Let's do some guesstimating and find out. There are a few things that have astronomical numbers. We're going to compare five quantities today. The number of grains of sand on Earth, stars in the known universe, molecules in a cup of water, words ever uttered in the history of humans, and the number of atoms in the universe. Of all these, which do you think is the largest? Which is the least? Are any of them bigger than a googol? Before you dive in, put your guess in the comments about the order of these quantities. None of these can be calculated strictly through mathematics, so we need some data to work with, but also some techniques that scientists use to get a handle on such big quantities. We'll do the estimates for the stars, words, and atoms in the universe and compare them with estimates others have done for grains of sand and molecules in a cup. Let's start with stars. How could we approximate the number of stars in the known universe? Well, stars tend to be grouped in galaxies. So if we know approximately the number of stars in each galaxy and the number of galaxies, then we could just multiply. One way scientists have estimated the number of galaxies is by taking a picture of a piece of the night sky and counting the number of observable galaxies, then multiply by the number of pictures needed to photograph every part of the sky. Here's one picture from the Hubble Space Telescope. Some of these blobs are actually galaxies, and those specks of light that you can barely see are also galaxies, just so far away that they appear like a single star. There are about 15,000 galaxies in this picture. This picture is a pretty small area of the night sky. I couldn't find the size detail for this picture, but I found that the field of view of one of the Hubble Space Telescopes is about the size of a tennis ball from 100 meters away. So we can use this information to find out how many tennis balls we would need to line a sphere of radius 100 meters with tennis balls. I think one easy way to find out the number of tennis balls is to find the radius of the sphere in tennis balls, then use the surface area formula for a sphere. A tennis ball is about 6.7 centimeters in diameter. Converting that to meters and dividing into 100 gives us about 1,493 tennis balls. Plug that into our formula for surface area, and we get about 28 million tennis balls. So it would take that many images to capture the entire sky. If the density of galaxies from the previous image is representative, then there are about 15,000 galaxies for every one of those 28 million images. So about 420 billion galaxies. Our math ends up being a little short. One astronomer claimed the scientists think there are about 2 trillion galaxies, but at least we're in the right ballpark. To calculate the number of stars in a galaxy, we can use our Milky Way galaxy as an example. Scientists say that our spiral galaxy is about 100,000 light years across and about 1,000 light years thick. The nearest star to us is about 4 light years away. If that's a typical distance, then every star would have about 64 cubic light years of space around it. The volume of our Milky Way can be approximated by using the formula for the volume of a cylinder. The volume is about 7.8 trillion cubic light years. Dividing by 64 gets us an estimate of about 122 billion stars. And that is huge. I don't think we appreciate how large galaxies are. Unlike stars that are relatively small and far apart, galaxies are more like pool balls on a pool table, even colliding like pool balls. Okay, not the same type of collision. Galaxies tend to pass through each other when they collide since there's so much empty space. Well, now we can finally get an estimate of the number of stars in the observable universe. Multiplying the number of stars per galaxy times the number of galaxies gives us about 5 times 10 to the 22nd power. We're in the right ballpark, but scientists with more knowledge and better techniques than I have give estimates between 10 to the 23rd and 10 to the 24th. We're actually closer than we really deserve to be with our rough calculations and estimates. Well, how big is 10 to the 24th? Well, we can try to compare it to values of things that we're more familiar with. It's larger than estimates of the grains of sand on Earth, which is estimated to be around 7.5 times 10 to the 17th. It's not even close. For each grain of sand on Earth, there are maybe tens or hundreds of thousands of stars. The number of stars is about the same as the number of molecules in a cup of water. Estimates for that are also around 10 to the 24th. Although you wouldn't have learned to do that in chemistry class because they would have given you the problem in milliliters and not cups. So that leads us to our next value, the number of words uttered in the history of mankind. That's also an astronomical number. We have billions of people speaking thousands of words each day, and humans have been around for millennia, so the number of words has got to be up there. How could we calculate the number of words ever uttered in the history of mankind? This one's not too complicated if we know a few benchmark numbers. First, how many words does an average person speak each day? Others have estimated this at 16,000 words. That means in my lifetime, if I lived to be 78, which is the current average lifespan of humans, I would say over 455 million words. Well, what about the number of humans that have ever lived? Some have estimated a total of 117 billion humans that have existed. That number might seem surprisingly low to you if you consider how long humans have been on Earth and that our current world population is over 8 billion. But we can't just multiply 455 million by 117 billion. At least that would give us an overestimate because the average lifespan of humans has not always been 78 years. In fact, in just 1900, the average life expectancy was only 47 years. Modern medicine really has done miracles for the human race. During the Neolithic era, the average life expectancy is estimated to be just 30 years. So instead, let's take the total number of humans ever in existence, multiply by an average life expectancy of 40 years, then again by 1,600 words a day, and then again by 365 days in a year. That gets us a little more than 10 to the 19th. Another way to estimate the number of words ever spoken is with an integral. An integral is a mathematical summing machine. If you don't know much about integration, you can watch our previous video about how to think about integration for applied math problems. Instead of using our previous strategy of total number of people times the words in a lifetime, we could have approached the problem by multiplying the number of people alive each year times the average number of words one person speaks each year, and then add up the product for each year. Since different years have different number of people, there are a different number of words spoken each year. We can use a simple exponential growth model to approximate the number of people alive each year, then multiply that by the approximate words per year. Notice, since we're adding up a bunch of products, that is what clues us in that we might be able to use an integral. Now we can integrate over all the years there have been significant human populations on the Earth to get our estimate. With this method, we get the same ballpark as our first estimate, about 8.7 times 10 to the 18th. Now, you're probably thinking, that is so much math overkill. Why would you do that when we could just do the simple multiplication? Well, we were only able to do the simple multiplication strategy by looking up the value of the number of people that have ever lived, and that is also calculated using integration. How could we find the number of people that ever lived? We could add up the number of people born every year. But we don't have records to know the number of births each year, so we would need to approximate it with a mathematical model. We could easily change our previous population model to give us a total number of births by multiplying by a birth rate. If this expression here tells us the number of people, and on average, there are 40 births per 1,000 people over the history of all humans, then we can multiply our population by 0.04 to get the number of new humans each year. Now we can integrate over all years where there were significant human populations, and we get a value of about 59 billion. That was about half of the 117 billion estimate we found online, but considering our simple model, that's still pretty good. It was hard for me to find the average birth rate over time, but it was almost 40 per 1,000 people in 1950, and increasing as we went back in time. So maybe that estimate is too low, and that's why our total estimate is low. So the number of words ever uttered in the history of humankind is about the same order of magnitude as the number of grains of sand on Earth. But the number of stars is about the same magnitude as the number of water molecules in a glass of water. Well, if we want to talk about big numbers, we can go bigger than these. Most viewers will be familiar with the number googol. It's a 1 followed by 100 zeros, or 10 to the 100. We have one final question. How many atoms are in the observable universe? We can use some of our previous estimates and do a little more math to get an estimate pretty quickly. Since there are about 10 to the 24th molecules in a glass of water, we'll round up to 10 to the 25th for the number of atoms in a liter. There are 1,000 liters per cubic meter, and the volume of the sun is about 1.4 times 10 to the 27th cubic meters. There are also about 10 to the 24th stars in the known universe, so now we can multiply those four values together and get an estimate of something around 10 to the 79th. But that only counts atoms in stars. What about non-star matter? Well, even if there are trillions and trillions of non-star atoms for every star atom, we will still not be close to a googol. So no, there are not a googol atoms in the observable universe. Now here's your challenge. Could our observable universe even hold a googol atoms? Do your calculations and let us know in the comments. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.